echo from the ages.
And Adam knew Eve, and she bare Cain.
That was the first human birth recorded in history, and the first verse, fourth chapter of Genesis.
This is Face to the Future, a new transcribed series on this station produced in cooperation with the North American Air Defense Command. Its conductor is Del Vina, well-known broadcaster, author, lecturer, a lady of adventure as well. It's Face to the Future. And here is our hostess, Del Vina.
Welcome to Face to the Future. First off, let's talk about the figure 13. It's bad luck to the superstitious. But do you know why? More people are asking why about everything these days, so why should we be different? 13 became the symbol of bad luck in antiquity because primitive men with minimum mathematics counted by using their fingers and 2 feet. The resultant figure of 12 was handy in trade because it could be divided by 4 smaller figures, 2, 3, 4, and 6. 13 couldn't be divided by any whole number, so it became the mathematical great beyond, troublesome, difficult, and therefore bad luck. Face to the Future will be a series of 13 individual programs, each of the subjects treated, unable to be separated or divided from the other. Unless we are able to handle them better than primitive men could deal with the figure 13, then bad luck, the number, will remain for all of us. Not since the era of discovery and exploration initiated by Columbus has the future looked more exciting. The race into that future has begun to alter politics and the pulpit. It has created hard searches for power and propulsion. In this future we face, nothing is surer than that it will be a rich future if we go after it, or that there will be problems wherein lie opportunities for our children and theirs. First is birth rate. Everything will stem from it, both problems and solutions. It has entrapped some parts of the world already. Nehru wishes India had just half its population. Birth control in England has the blessing of the Church of England. Italy still has laws against it, dating from Mussolini, who was trying for a high birth rate to man his armies. France has a law against contraceptives, about as well enforced as our prohibition was. Khrushchev has made statements wanting Soviet families to have at least 3 or 4 children each, reflecting his concern that he may have to fight China's encroachments on Siberia in the future. Japan had 1 million abortions last year. Such things as birth rate were the substance of jokes 30 years ago.
I must tell you, gentlemen, at the outset of this speech that I am an Irishman. You know about Irishmen, of course. Once there were 2. Now there are millions.
From the 30s, when that joke was popular, to our time, the birth rate, which will change mankind's history, has gone from an after-dinner joke to a potential jeopardy for humanity. At the birth of Christ, there were 350 million people on earth, and few lived past 30. There are nearly 9 times that many today, prospects of 18 times that many by the year 2000. Our Congress has interested itself in birth rate, and it has become a political issue. At the University of California, Professor William Peterson has written a new book called Population. I asked him how many people there were on Earth today and how many would be here in 40 years.
The usual estimate for the world population today is about 2.7 or 2.8 billion. This is increasing at the rate of about 100,000 persons per day. If this rate of increase continues to the end of this century, to the year 2000, the population of the world will be of the order of 6 billion.
How much of this problem is centered on North America?
In the North American continent, we have a rapidly increasing population. This is much more, I think, than is healthy. And we are already running into fundamental problems like shortage of water in the whole Southwest. And in Canada, every indication is that their population increase is under what it might be.
If we wait to face this future problem in North America, what will have to be done?
The difficulties of reversing it at that time will be considerably greater than at the present time, because now we still have a certain amount of room in every sense of this word to work with, and this room is disappearing.
We hear all manner of presentations to the effect that nature wouldn't have created a situation in which population could outrun food supply and place of residence. Is this realistic?
I think that this argument that a certain course is, quote, natural, is not ever a very convincing argument. We don't live naturally, and nobody really proposes that we do. If these people who speak about nature suggested that we stop cooking our food, and that we stop cultivating plants and animals, and that we stop wearing clothing, and that we go out and live in nature, then I might take their other arguments seriously, but I wouldn't take them seriously, because this is not a proposal that a sane man would want to follow.
It seems to me we have a lot of unnatural controls already.
We have a wholly unnatural control of mortality. All of the conditions that lead to early death in a primitive society, almost all of them have come under control to a marked degree. We've controlled almost everything except old age as a cause of death. This means that we take nature as a base, but we manipulate nature enormously.
Today, Nehru says India would be better off with half its population. At what time in American life, for instance, might there be a president confronted with an equal population tragedy?
I hope and trust that the present increase in the population of the United States will never be permitted to reach the dimensions of that exist in India and similar countries today before Americans will exercise their intelligence and do something about it.
Does such a population spread tend to have war-making implications? Could it generate the makings of war?
I do think that if you have a regime which is interested in spreading itself, say, for example, the communist regime of China, which wants to move over Southeast Asia as far apparently as it can get, they can justify their attempts to conquer other peoples in terms of a demand for Lebensraum, just as Hitler did. So that given a certain political framework, which unfortunately is still rather common in the world today, I think that population pressure can be a strong aggravating factor.
To you as a sociologist, where does this lead? What conclusion?
So long as we have an, quote, unnatural death control, we have to balance this by an equally, quote, unnatural birth control.
Many wise men and women have said that there are lessons in history, and that the historian is one worth listening to. He knows man for what he has been, and what he has been, he's likely to be because he changes slowly. Here is one of the world's great historians, England's Arnold Toynbee.
We are all concerned for the salvation of our fellow human beings. We are all concerned to move them to make individual choices that will bring a better life within the reach of them and their children. We too must have faith in the human nature that is common to all men. If we have this faith, we can be equal to the task of helping these millions of human beings to save themselves. We can help them to choose right in making man's perennial choice between life and good and death and evil. But the decisions have to be taken by each one of us for himself. No one can take them for his neighbor.
The mother of today's youngster who will enter kindergarten next fall may wonder what this world and its environment will be at the year 2000. He will be about 45 years old, with a better than average chance of living to be 90. Whatever career he elects, he will have to make decisions in a world twice as heavily populated as now. I asked Professor Peterson to describe his world.
By the year 2000, there will no longer be arable land as there is now, for example, in Africa. The overpopulation now characteristic of India will be characteristic of the entire Earth's livable surface. There will be one Chinese to each other person on Earth. There may well be schools for sea farming, as today there are schools for land agriculture, in order to provide the additional food we will need. Atomic energy may be available to melt the polar ice, to provide water to irrigate the Sahara. The 6 billion people living on Earth, therefore, may not be short of food, but they will certainly be less comfortable, more crowded. The population will bring about a sharper competition among nations for goods and for living space, and there will therefore be greater likelihood of major wars.
So many things started with Cain, the biblical first baby. He was a problem child, and as he acted, nations of people like him have acted. He taught us by killing his own brother that nations of men must be alert and ready to defend themselves. If we are twice as many people in the year 2000, whether we are twice as rich or twice as poor, we will be twice as concerned for our security from surface or space attack. Your sons and daughters will be making decisions. And how right those decisions will be guided by how intensively they have been prepared, how well they understand the consequences of action and inaction.
This has been Face to the Future, a transcribed series on this station, produced in cooperation with the North American Air Defense Command and featuring Delvina with her parade of interesting guests. Be with us next time as we put our face to the future.